The Lakers kicked off their season with a big win last night against the Minnesota Timberwolves, and we learned a lot from this game. I've got three takeaways from the Lakers' big opening night win against the Wolves. I'm Trevor Lane. This is the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Big shout out to BetUS for sponsoring this video. Make sure you do subscribe to the channel. Turn on those notifications as well. Seriously, hit the subscribe button. Stay in the know on all things Lakers. All right, let's kick things off here. I got three takeaways from Lakers, Wolves. What a great performance by LA. Fantastic way to start off the season. It wasn't all perfect, but let's dive into it. First of all, Anthony Davis. What a monstrous performance from AD. And he's incredible. He's been incredible for a long time. He's been absolutely phenomenal. 36 points, 16 rebounds, 4 assists, 1 steal, 3 blocks. And here's the crazy thing. He didn't shoot that well. He was in a shooting slump until, what was it, maybe midway through the third quarter? Then he got himself going, and next thing you know, in the fourth quarter, he's hitting fadeaways in the paint, floating to his left, nothing but net. Anthony Davis is phenomenal, and this wasn't even his best performance. He was everywhere on the defensive side. The rebounds, doing everything the team needed him to there, and he absolutely destroyed Rudy Gobert, the so-called defensive player of the year. Rudy Gobert, Anthony Davis, snatched his soul with that absolutely unreal block that we saw. Gobert thought he had an easy dunk. Anthony Davis said, no, not today. That's not happening. So this is, I think, a great sign for the Lakers big picture, because this is not the first we're seeing of AD being this dominant. We saw it a lot last season. Anthony Davis is obviously a tremendous talent, and everyone knows that. But there's this idea around AD that he's not a true 1A guy, that he's more of a 1B guy. He's more of a second fiddle. And when he has performances like this, you look at it and you go, oh no, that's the guy. That's the dude. That is a 1A superstar out there on the floor. He was phenomenal. It's nothing new. We've seen him be fantastic, but we also saw him very locked in preseason. So this is a continuation of that. Anthony Davis was very focused in preseason. We saw him put up some big performances, obviously not going all out because it's preseason, but I think this game, this outing, was perhaps a sign to the NBA that this is going to be a big year for AD, because he was excellent. Now, part of it is AD tends to get up to play against Rudy Gobert. I think that, you know, AD talked about over the summer that he doesn't believe he's ever going to win Defensive Player of the Year, that he just thinks they're never going to give it to him. I think it bothers him. I really do. I think it does bother him that he is, I believe, the greatest defensive player of his generation and has never won Defensive Player of the Year. I think he's been robbed multiple times when he should have won the award. And now I like that he's already setting that narrative. Check it out. This is what he said after the game, and watch how he just kind of drops the Defensive Player of the Year award. Check this out.
Timing on those two blocks. Is it about just identifying where the shot taker is going to be?
The Defensive Player of the Year type stuff.
Yes, it is. All right, and I agree.
I love the knowing glance at the camera. That's Defensive Player of the Year type stuff. And he's right to do that. Sometimes this stuff is very narrative based, right? And so you want to start that narrative very early that he should be Defensive Player of the Year. In fact, if you go over to BetUS right now, Anthony Davis currently is a plus 1600 to win Defensive Player of the Year. Now, back in August, he was plus 1800. So after the opener, after he dropped that little casual, you know, this Defensive Player of the Year type stuff, after he dropped that, the odds of him winning Defensive Player of the Year actually increased. They went up because I think people went, yeah, Anthony Davis should be the Defensive Player of the Year. And again, if he plays the way he did last night, he's going to get a lot of attention for that award. It's funny because people are just like handing it over to Victor Wembanyama. He's seen it such a heavy favorite. Last I looked, I believe he was a minus 200. He's such a heavy favorite to win the award. It's like everybody's just giving it to him already. And Anthony Davis was put down below guys in terms of his odds, like Bam Adebayo, Rudy Gobert. These guys are good defensive players, but I thought last night we saw what it is that sets Anthony Davis apart. It's his ability to defend everywhere on the floor and absolutely take over a game. with his defense. But if you guys want to get in on it, you can check out BetUS. Again, great sponsor for the show. 150% sign-up bonus on your first deposit, and then 125% bonus on your second and third deposit up to $2,000. Use the promo code LakersNation. Go check out BetUS. But again, Anthony Davis, whew, what a performance, and I'm really excited for the season to come. By the way, guys, no question at this point, this is Anthony Davis's team. Officially. And that is not a shot at LeBron. That is not, should not be offensive to LeBron in any kind of way. He's been trying to give the team to Anthony Davis from day one. If you remember, one of the first things LeBron did when Anthony Davis arrived in LA was go to management and talk to them about running the offense through AD. LeBron has been looking to pass this torch for a long time. I think it did get passed last season. It became more Anthony Davis's team, but it was still close, the split between the two. I think this is firmly Anthony Davis's team. LeBron is still going to have his nights. There's no question. He's still phenomenal. But this is AD's Los Angeles Lakers at this point. All right. The second takeaway, all about the margins. And this is something JJ Redick talks about a lot. But when we look at the margins, and this is the areas that really add up, the areas that maybe don't initially jump off the screen at you, but they're ultimately what can determine winning and losing, because the difference between the two, between winning and losing, it's a very thin margin in the NBA. A few missed shots here, a few turnovers there, and that can turn a game that you should win into a loss. So it's about winning the margins and creating those extra opportunities. And that's exactly what the Lakers did. So when we look at the Lakers' shooting percentage in this game, it's not good. It's not good at all. In fact, I can only imagine what it's going to look like once they get some threes to drop. But you look at what the Lakers did in this one. The field goal percentage, 44%. The Lakers were one of the better NBA teams last season in terms of field goal percentage, and that in part was because of their low three-point volume. They didn't have a high three-point volume. In fact, it was about the same as it was last season, 30 attempts from three in this game, but they still couldn't get going. Again, Anthony Davis missed some chippies in the game, especially early in the first, you know, 2.5 quarters or so. Max Christie went 0-for-3. Bronny was 0-for-2, you know, D'Angelo Russell 4-for-12, LeBron 7-for-16, guys just shot a little bit below average. And then you look at the three-point shooting, 17%, I'm rounding up to get there, from three. That's not good enough. So why did the Lakers win, even though they shot so terribly? Well, look at the margins. Look at what they were able to produce. 7 turnovers. That's insane. For an opening night, I expected a sloppy performance against a good Wolves team. If you asked me ahead of the game, if you had to bet on anything, I would say above average turnovers for the Lakers, because the Wolves defense is excellent. We saw it in the second half of the game in particular. The Wolves started really trying to pressure the Lakers guards and force them into turnovers. You saw the defense extend from Minnesota, and that's one of the things that makes them a good team, is their ability to really be a problem, especially on the perimeter defensively. I thought Dante DiVincenzo was fantastic on the defensive side of the ball. Anthony Edwards can cause some problems there too. Mike Conley is still an incredibly smart defensive player, the way that he approaches things. So this is a good team. In addition to, of course, Jaden McDaniels is a great wing defender. He was in foul trouble though, but the margins made up for the poor shooting. 7 turnovers for the Lakers and then 15 offensive rebounds. How about that? 15 offensive rebounds for a team that essentially punted offensive rebounding last season. Now, part of it is they missed so many shots. They didn't shoot the ball well. That created more opportunities for offensive rebounds. But still, that's a phenomenal sign. And look who got them. I think this is when JJ Redick talks about the margins. Look who got them. Rui Hachimura. Look, AD got 3 offensive rebounds. That's great, right? But it's AD. You expect him to. Rui Hachimura, 3 offensive rebounds. Oh. Okay, he averaged 1 per game last season. 1, actually just under, 0.9 per game last season, Rui Hachimura. JJ Redick has challenged him to be a better defensive or a better rebounding player this season. 5 rebounds total, that's just okay. That's a little bit above his average. I think he averaged 4 last season. But 3 offensive boards, that's exact. I mean, JJ's asked him to be a corner crasher, and he did it in this game. I thought it was an excellent performance, by the way, from Rui Hachimura. Austin Reeves. 4 offensive rebounds. Look at that. 9 boards. Austin Reeves, the second highest rebound total on the Lakers behind Anthony Davis. What a performance from him on the glass. How many times did we see Austin get into the middle of the paint, elevate? Man, he got up and grabbed the rebound away from Wolves players. And on the offensive glass, when he misses, he's gotten, and we saw it in preseason too, Austin is getting really good at reading when he misses, where the rebound is going and getting to that spot. It reminds you of that very famous, if you haven't seen it, look it up, the famous, I don't want to credit a Celtic here, but there's a famous Larry Bird play where he misses, I believe it was a free throw, and the ball bounces off to the right side. He follows his own miss and then puts it right back up and in for 2 points. In fact, he did it kind of Tippett style where he did it in midair. Austin is doing that kind of stuff in terms of the way he's tracking the ball, and that's allowed him to be a factor as well on the offensive glass. That's how you get extra possessions. 15 offensive rebounds, and I think if there's anything we learned from the Celtics and Knicks game last night, it's how valuable offensive boards are. I talk about it a lot. Offensive rebounds tend to produce the two most valuable shots in half-court basketball, and that's shots at the rim and open threes. Those are the two most valuable shots in terms of points per possession in basketball. And the Lakers, by getting 15 offensive rebounds, you create more of those. I think the NBA in general is waking up to how valuable offensive rebounds can be. We saw it. The Celtics were killing the Knicks. Every time they were able to get an offensive rebound, it turned into a made three. Just didn't. Now they shot 63s in last night's game, but that was a great example of why offensive boards are so important and so valuable, and why JJ Redick, going the complete opposite strategy of Darvin Ham last season, why he's emphasized it so much, because they aren't so incredibly valuable. Look at this. The Lakers didn't shoot well, but 95 attempts compared to the Wolves, 85 attempts, 10 more attempts at the basket. That's a big difference. That, I mean, the Lakers won by 7. That's the game. 10 extra attempts. That's the game. And that's the turnovers. The Wolves finished with 15 turnovers to just 7 for the Lakers, and that's the offensive glass. The Lakers win the battle of the offensive boards 15-12. The Wolves did get better on the glass in the second half, but still, JJ Redick talks about winning on the margins. The Lakers did exactly that in this game, and it's why they ultimately walk away with the win on opening night. All right, and last thing. Again, these will not all be positive when I do these the next day breakdowns, what we learned, all of that. There are some negatives from this game to take away. We look at, you know, Max Christie. Are there some concerns there? D'Angelo Russell's shooting still hasn't come around from preseason. There's some negatives. The three-pointers have not come around from preseason. It's still early. It's still small sample size. At some point, they need those shots to drop. But this was a great win. And JJ Redick's for real. That's it. JJ Redick's for real. I mean, I don't know what else to say. JJ, you know, coming in, and I don't think this is wrong, when JJ was announced as the head coach or was in the running to become the head coach, I said it's a risk. It's a risk for the Lakers to hire JJ Redick as their head coach. He's never coached before. That would typically not be the path you take on a team with LeBron James and Anthony Davis that needs to win right now and has no time for learning curve, has no time. In a Western Conference that's unforgiving, you have no time for somebody to learn on the job. You just don't. But you look at the way they're playing right now. I said it was a gamble. It's a high reward, potentially, if he's your guy long-term, but also pretty low floor. Things could go really bad if you hire a guy who's never coached before. And look, we're not out of the woods. I'm not saying everything is perfect. Who knows what things look like in January and in February. But so far, my God, I mean, check all the boxes. Yes, the ball needs to go in the basket, but JJ Redick is developing them. They're creating shots. They're creating great looks. You look at the offense. You look at how inventive it is. You look at how much motion there is in the offense. That stagnation that we saw so much last season, despite being a good option or a good offense, it's mostly gone. And we're seeing ball movement. We're seeing player movement. We're seeing screens. We're seeing creativity. We're seeing guys flash to the basket for easy looks that they weren't getting last season. We're seeing an offense that is, number one, it's a lot of fun to watch. Imagine how fun it's going to be once we get a D'Lo heater game from three. Imagine how much fun the offense is going to be then. And number two, it's a pain in the ass to defend. This is a Wolves team that was the best team in the NBA defensively last season, and the Lakers were giving them problems trying to defend this. The offense JJ Redick has put in is very, very good. And then defensively, I like what we're seeing. Anthony Davis not necessarily tethered to the basket. And part of this was Minnesota, right? Part of it was, hey, what's going to happen when teams don't respect Julius Randle that much behind the three-point line and he's on the floor with Rudy Gobert? What's the spacing going to look like? The spacing was not great. It was not great for the Wolves in last night's game. But the Lakers took advantage of that. And so I thought defensively, most of what they did made more sense. Did they still give up a few open threes? Yes. But it sure wasn't like the offense from last year where it was, well, daring three-point shooters. Saying that guy is a 32% three-point shooter, let's just leave him open. Again, that was not the entire defensive scheme, but we saw it very often. The Lakers gave up more open threes last season than any other team, and they were just hoping that guys who shoot 32%, say, on average, will not see their percentage go up to, say, 40% when they're wide open. And guess what they found out? It does, because NBA players are really good. Even if they're not seen as a good three-point shooter, if you leave them wide open, they're going to knock them down. So the defensive schemes, I thought, were very good as well. JJ Redick clearly has these guys bought in. And I'll tell you the other thing that I really liked. And maybe it's just the connection. It's just when you watch JJ on the sideline, and I know people got on Darvin Ham all the time for having his hands in his pockets, and that presented this sort of lackadaisical image, right? My hands are in my pockets. Whatever's happening is happening. I'm not an active participant in the game. I'm just kind of here for the ride. And I'm not saying that's what Darvin Ham was doing, but it was the message that was conveyed. And based on the coaching style, the lack of timeouts, lack of challenges, all that kind of stuff, it was the message that was conveyed. When you see JJ Redick on the sideline and you see the intensity, you see the concern on his face, you see the anger. Late in the game, the Lakers are up 9. Rui Hachimura gets fouled. The game's over, and JJ Redick's barking at the referees about the missed call. Like, yeah, there's that familiarity where you go, damn. Darvin Ham talks about, would talk about, hey, you know, it's ridiculous that I'm paraphrasing, but it's ridiculous that we're living and dying with every single game. JJ Redick is living and dying with every single game, and as Lakers fans, we can relate to that. We go, yes, that's how I feel. That's the way I am acting during these games. JJ is reflective of that. And not only is I think a better attitude in terms of what you present to the team, but I just think it's a different vibe around this club right now. And it's got me very excited for what this team can be. Again, I thought JJ Redick was a risk hiring him. There were more known quantities out there, but this was the high upside swing. Long way to go. By no means is this, you know, unfurl the mission accomplished banner or anything like that. Long way to go. But so far, you go all the way back to the summer, up to now, and nearly every single beat, every single moment, JJ's hit it out of the park. The offense started to come together during the preseason. We started to get glimpses of what he was trying to do. And now here we are in the regular season, and we see that come to fruition. Whew. Again, I don't want to get too far ahead of ourselves. But so far, JJ Redick is absolutely killing it as the coach of the Lakers. Again, there will be bumps in the road. There will be moments where the inexperience shows. I'm sure of that. That's going to happen. That's only natural. That's to be expected. But so far, man, you can't not be excited by what you're seeing from JJ Redick right now and the way he's got these Lakers playing. Lakers Nation, give me your thoughts in the comments down below. What were your takeaways from this game? What did we learn out there on the floor from this Lakers team? So many good things. We'll have the new Lakers Nation podcast. That'll be out tomorrow. I'm going to break down this game a little bit further. We'll start looking ahead to Phoenix coming up on Friday. Great way to start the season with a win for the Lakers. Again, don't forget to subscribe right here to the YouTube channel. Till next time, everybody. I want to make sure I give a big shout out, of course, to BetUS, fantastic sponsor for the show. You guys make sure you go check them out. See ya and stay safe.